morning, church. It's a beautiful day. How crisp and windy and beautiful so this. How about we worship the Lord this morning? Yes, amen? So we're going to invite you to stand up if you're able to, and let's sing this together. Grateful for everything. So let's just continue worshiping the Lord this morning.
And all I see is the battle. You see my victory. As I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, So when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I see through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. Almighty fortress, you go before us. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. You shine in the shadows, you win every battle. Nothing can stand against the power of our God. So when I fight, I fight on my knees with my hands lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you, and every fear I lay at your feet. I see through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Oh God, the battle belongs to you.
Amen. Amen. We know this one. We ask you to join us and just let the lyrics resonate within our hearts.
Grace abounds.
Thank you, to glorify you, Lord, to praise you, because you are the creator of everything. There are some times, Lord, that we just let go and trust, Lord, that's where we are the most safe, because that's where you are, Lord. In our most vulnerable state, you are always there, and that's all that we need, Lord, in this life and in ever, in eternity, Lord. We are just grateful to be here today. We are just praying, Lord, for the Spirit to be here this morning and everyone, and the words that come from our pastor and from the speaker this morning, Lord, they're just resonating in our hearts, and that we can take them within us through the whole day and the week and forevermore, Lord. In Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen. Good morning and welcome to Crux Center Ministries Church. We're so glad you're here. If you're here for the first time, we're very glad you're here and we welcome you. If you're here online watching later, we're so glad you joined us. And we want you to know that we meet here every Sunday at 10. We meet on Tuesdays at 6 for dinner and fellowship and talk about the Sunday sermon. We meet Thursdays for Bible study at 6. So there's so much more women's ministries after church. We're just glad you're here, glad you're a part of Crux Center Ministries, and hope that you are involved with everything that we have to offer you. Well, as a call to worship this morning, and the word is safety today, if you're following along with our sermon series on building connections and our values, it came to mind that the image of Jesus calling chicks under his wings, right, and calling them safe. I don't know if you're familiar with this passage, but he said, "Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those to you, sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, and you were not willing." And then he might have been referring to the Old Testament passage in Psalm 91, that whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and fortress, my God in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare and from the deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. God is a place of safety for us. Jesus is a place of safety, and I hope that you feel that here today.
One of the ways that we follow Jesus that Stacy mentioned is meeting here together, worshiping together on Sundays. During the week, we come together. The scripture in Hebrews says, let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing. So we want to stay in the habit of meeting together. Not always, but enough to where it's a part of the rhythm of our life is to come together and to worship Jesus together and to be together. That's what the church is, right? Bunch of people, followers of Jesus, meeting together and going out into the world and sharing Christ. Another way that we follow Jesus is by giving of our tithes and offerings. So if you want to do that, there's two silver towers at the entrance exits of the theater. But also you could go to tithe.ly, which is the way that we tithe. It's very simple. You go to tithe.ly and look up the Salvation Army San Diego Croc Center and choose that, and that's where you can tithe right online. Every time that you want to. The Bible says to be a generous and joyful giver. So that's the kind of followers of Jesus we want to be. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this time that we have together today. We don't want to take it for granted. We want to really be here, to be present. We know that you are present, Father. We know that you are present, Jesus. We know that you are present, Holy Spirit. And we're just thankful, and we're also needy. And we trust you today that you have something for us, and that we'll leave here not perfect people, but people that are following your son, Jesus, filled with the Holy Spirit, and wanting to bring glory to you and good for others. May it be so in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. I'll be reading scripture today. 1 Timothy 4, verses 1 through 16. The Spirit clearly says that in later times, some will abandon the faith and follow deceiving spirits and things taught by demons. Such teachings comes through hypocritical leaders who have been seared as with a hot iron. They forbid people to marry and others them to abstain from certain foods which God creates to be received with thanksgiving by those who believe and who knows the truth. For everything God creates is good, and nothing is to be rejected if it is received with thanksgiving, because it is consecrated by the word of God in prayer. If you point these things out to your brothers and sisters, minister of Christ Jesus, nourished on the truth of faith and of the good teaching that you have followed. Have nothing to do with godless myths and old wives' tales. Rather, train yourself to be godly. For physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise for both the present life and life to come. This is trustworthy saying that deserves full acceptance. That is why we labor and strive, because we have put our hope in living God, who is Savior of all people, and especially of those who believe. Command and teach these things. Don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and purity. Until I come, devote yourself to the public reading of Scripture, to preach and to teach. Do not neglect your gift, which was given you through prophecies when the body of elders laid their hands on you. Do be diligent in these matters. Give yourself wholly to them so that everyone many sees your progress. Watch your life and doctrines closely. Preserve in them, because if you do not, you will save both yourself and your hands.
Thanks, Michael. You know, I wasn't going to mention this, but in that scripture, which we're not going to really land on the verse, but in 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 12, this is for all you young people in the congregation today. It says that, you know, Paul, the Apostle Paul, is writing to Timothy, who was young, and he says in 1 Timothy 4, 12, don't let anyone look down on you because you are young, but set an example for the believers in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. And I've always, even when I was young, maybe especially when I was young, I took comfort in that verse, because it means that anybody, kids, teens, like preteens, teens, young adults, people who just feel young, people who are younger than other people in any given context, can really be an example for others in speech, in conduct, in love, in faith, and in purity. It's not just the old saints that have it all together, but a child can lead them. So that's just a little bit of encouragement, I think. As Stacy mentioned, we are on the second Sunday of our current series, Building Connections, where we're taking a closer biblical look at the purpose statement and the five values that have been agreed upon here at the Salvation Army Croc Center. So we're talking about not just Croc Center Ministry as a part of the Croc Center, but the whole Croc Center. The employees were surveyed, and all kinds of things happened in order to come up with this purpose statement of building connections. That's what we want to be about here at the Croc Center. And then we also came up with five values, kind of not a roadmap, but what these five values we want in our life here at the Croc Center. And so that's what we're looking at during this sermon series. Last week, Major Stacy unpacked for us the importance just of building connections, the purpose statement, building connections in our lives. As followers of Jesus, loving God and loving others are the two most important of those connections, for sure, at least according to Jesus. Like, don't take my word for it. It's according to Jesus from, she showed us from Mark 12, but also it's in various other places. Loving God and loving others seems like that's what it's all about when we follow Jesus. And today we begin to focus on those five values. So Stacy gave it away, but you know, what is first? We all know that Safety first, right? Safety first. Safety is a big deal in our lives. When we're kids, the good people in our lives help us to avoid danger, right? They teach us all kinds of ways to avoid, look both ways, don't touch the hot stove. There's all kinds of things that the good people in our life do to keep us from harm, keep us out of harm's way. Our society has laws to keep us safe. In a workplace, there's no end to the emails and the trainings and the manuals in order to keep people safe, but also to keep up on productivity. That's also a factor in those things. Unfortunately, these days, kids in school have to go through all kinds of training to be safe in terrible situations. So safety is a big deal for most of us, from a kid all the way till we're older. And I want to share with you this little safety film in a moment that is for the workplace, and then we're going to see if it has any connotations for us in our spiritual lives as well. Let's roll film.
A danger lurks down every hallway, across every factory floor, within every one of our offices. This danger cannot be seen by the naked eye, nor can it be heard, touched, tasted, or even smelled. Personal protective equipment does little against it. It is the single most common cause of injury in today's workplace. What is this silent and devious danger that surrounds our every move? It's called complacency. To become complacent with our own safety can turn the ordinary, the mundane, the routine tasks that we complete daily into the perfect recipe for disaster. We tell ourselves, it won't happen to me. But we are only kidding ourselves. Something always happens. Blinded to the mistakes that will be made. And if we aren't focused on the task, routine or not, if we don't take our safety seriously, if we aren't aware of our own complacency, we will become its victim. Nothing is routine.
Videos I watched this week. that was one of the last ones, but if you ever want to just have a good time for a little bit, watch Safety Fails, and or actually maybe not necessarily a good time, but what's that word, Schadenfreude or something like that, where you see other people make mistakes. But this was one of the last ones I watched. I thought they could have been a little more creative. I wondered what was going to happen with that pencil. I knew it wasn't going to be good, but I thought it was going to be a little more graphic than that, so I'm glad that they took that route. But a couple of the quotes that I wanted to pull out from that just in these opening moments is, it's the perfect recipe for disaster, complacency. Perfect recipe for disaster. And then this one really, for some reason, hit me hard. Just the quote that we often think, it won't happen to me. You know, we see somebody else get into some danger, maybe because we think of bad choices they made, and then we think, well, it wouldn't happen to me. Then complacency sits in, and more of a chance, right? So I'm going to suggest this morning that what's true in the workplace is also true in our spiritual lives. Any of us who claim to follow Jesus And what's at stake here is more than just a small chemical reaction or a trip on a pencil or even, and we can only assume here, a stapled finger. Complacency in a spiritual life kills. Like, this is really a matter of life and death. Complacency in a spiritual life kills. We need a safety plan. And fortunately, the scriptures provide many God-inspired verses designed to help us to avoid danger that leads to death and instead learn some lessons that lead to life. If we want to live well, we would do well to pay attention to what's going on around us. Unlike the lady in the hallway, right? But also to what's going on inside us. I shared before my favorite author, Frederick Buechner, his life lesson really was, listen to your life. So we need to pay attention to what's going on around us, and we need to pay attention to what's going on inside us. And as the safety video we just watched instructs us, if we aren't focused, if we don't take our safety seriously, if we aren't aware of our own complacency, we will become its victim. Let's pray. Your Father, in this dangerous world, we want to trust you to keep us safe. Help us just to spend a few moments looking to your word and hearing what you have for us today. And may we leave here trusting you more. In Jesus' name, amen. In the next few minutes, I want to suggest that each of us needs to, in our Christian walk, remember we're not really talking about the workplace or school or looking both ways before we cross the street, but in our Christian walk, we want to create a plan, we want to connect to a prayer, and we want to claim a promise. So first, let's start with the plan. Benjamin Franklin is quoted as saying, and I've said this before, I don't know if it was Benjamin Franklin, because, you know, you never can believe everything you see on the internet. I hope everyone knows that. It could have been, you know, Elvis Presley, it could have been W.C. Fields, it could have been Taylor Swift, who knows? But somebody said this, by failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. Since I messed that up, I'll say it again. By failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail. So whoever said it, I think it's really a good summary of what we're talking about here. Many times, I think people become Christians and they think they've arrived, right? People become Christians and they think they've arrived. And in one sense, they have. In one very real sense, they have arrived. But in another also very real sense, when we come to Jesus, when anybody comes to Jesus, young and old, we've just only begun, right? The Bible makes it clear over and over and in all kinds of ways that Christians are to be growing. It's all throughout Scripture, especially the New Testament. Growing into Christ's likeness is one way that we put it. Living holy lives is another way that we say it. It doesn't make sense, does it, for someone to claim to follow Jesus and then not follow Jesus. Does that make sense? Like, if we claim to be Christians, we're saying we're disciples of Jesus, we're learners of Jesus, we're followers of Jesus. But if we just become Christians and then stagnate, it doesn't make sense. When we don't follow Jesus, when we're complacent about our Christianity, danger Will Robinson, right? Danger, danger. Now, it's impossible in a fallen world to avoid all danger. It's just impossible. But if we don't have a safety plan, then we're sure to encounter it more often. And when we do encounter it, we're defenseless against it if we're not following Jesus. So we need a safety plan. And I think the verse that we landed on in Michael's reading of the word today, 1 Timothy chapter 4, verse 16, and the first part says, "Watch your life and doctrine closely." Before it, it's, you know, don't, all these false teachers and all these myths and all the, Like, that's not the way we want to live. We could add, these days, we could add conspiracy theories, all kinds of things that people come up with that aren't the truth. Right? So we want, as Jesus followers, to watch our life and our doctrine closely. That's a great safety plan, I think. It's a great safety plan. Now, at Croc Center Ministries here, nobody dictates a safety plan for us. None of us do that. And we don't have to do anything here to be here. It's not that kind of a congregation of believers. Nobody dictates how we watch our faith and our doctrine and our lives, how we grow into Christ-likeness, how we live a holy life. Nobody tells us that we have to do anything. And some tried and true methods have been discovered and passed on by Jesus followers over the centuries. And I'm just going to share some of them with you. This won't be all of them by any stretch. Bible reading, praying, silence. We heard one today in the scripture, the public teaching, the preaching of God's word, fasting, devotions, devotional reading, personal worship, corporate worship like we're doing here today, spending time with Christian friends, listening to meditative music. The list goes on and on and on. If a Jesus follower isn't involved in something, I'm not saying one of these, but something which helps them to grow, then not only will they not grow, but danger awaits them. And as I said, danger awaits all of us. But Christians aren't exempt from it. But a Christian who has a plan for what to do in danger's presence will be ready to meet it or to flee from it. Like, fight or flight isn't always a bad thing. It's real. Our bodies are created that way to tell us when to stand our ground and when to hit the road, right? One way to think of all that, being part of Croc Center Ministry Rhythm, is that everything that we offer here, things that Stacy mentioned, things that I mentioned, things that we mentioned in our weekly email, things that you might see on a web, everything we do here is to offer a safety plan or offer parts of a safety plan. We've all heard the phrase safety in numbers, right? I think that's another way of saying the church. Like, that's why we come together, is to be together and to know that we're not the only ones on this planet that are trying this thing, following Jesus. We're here together. Or as Stacy said, I think last week, each person is only a person with other persons, something like that, right? Every person is a person through other persons. We're created from community to be in community. So everything that we're about here at Croc Center Ministries is to offer some part of your safety plan, some part of my safety plan, safety in numbers. Because we need a safety plan. 1 Peter 5:8 tells us to be alert and of sober mind. He says, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Think of Jesus being tempted in the wilderness. He had a safety plan, right? Three times he responded to Satan's temptations with Scripture. Three times. And Satan hasn't given up. The roaring lion is still roaring. And the roaring lion is still prowling around looking for someone to devour. It's not just something that happened in biblical times. Satan's still looking to take life. In his classic tale, The Hobbit, J.R.R. Tolkien writes these words, "It does not do to leave a live dragon out of your calculations if you live near him." I'm just going to read it one more time because that's how I read J.R.R. Tolkien. I have to read it at least twice. It does not do to leave a live dragon out of your calculations if you live near him. In other words, in my words, if you live next door to a dragon, you better have a safety plan. Right? Guess what? We live next door to a dragon. I'm not talking about your neighbors. I'm not talking about who you're sitting by, but the dragon is close by. Right? The devil's still prowling around like a roaring lion, seeking someone to devour. We need a safety plan. Proverbs 27:12 says, the prudent see danger and take refuge, but the simple keep going and pay the penalty. I love Proverbs sometimes. They're great little quips and super meaningful. The prudent see danger and take refuge, but the simple keep going and pay the penalty. In 2021, when Stacy and I came to San Diego Croc Center, we were given one of these. Not this one exactly, because we've changed, as Stacy mentioned last week, we've changed the lanyard to be one that mentions building connections and the five values that we have. But every employee here should be wearing one of these. Not all have adapted yet, but we'll get there. And on the end of the lanyard is a picture, a name badge and a picture. It says it's got a great picture of me, and it says I'm the administrator. Apparently I'm the administrator and the mission integrator. Love it. Where I'm on the Croc crew. And on the other side is a safety plan. It's on the other side. I don't know why I'm holding it up. It's not like you can read it, but I guess this is proof that it's there. There's emergency color codes. There's a security cell number to call. There's examples like use plain speech. There's red is hard lockdown. Yellow is soft lockdown. There's a safety plan right here. I wear it every day. Guess how often I've looked at it in 2.5 years? Maybe 2.5 times. Now that could be a good thing because it means we haven't had to go to that. So there's a good side of that. The bad side of that is I wear this around my neck 5-6 times a week. It's just there, right? It's just there. It's just there. Doesn't do much help if I'm not familiar with it. So I want to ask this morning, do we have a safety plan? Do each of us have a safety plan when we're talking about our spiritual lives and when we're talking about the dangers that are lurking? Is it tucked away someplace safe, our safety plan? Like, is our safety plan in a safe? Which doesn't make much sense. Is it out of sight, out of mind? Or are we familiar with it? Are we engaged with it? Are we growing into Christ's likeness as we follow Jesus? Now, while having a safety plan, ways that will help us grow in Christ, is essential for the Christian, our growth, this is key, actually, our growth, our safety, isn't dependent on us, thankfully. Can you imagine how terrible it would be if staying safe in this world was totally up to us? I mean, disastrous, right? If I created a safety plan and I thought that was it, me, I would get into all kinds of trouble and not know how to get out of it. It would be deadly, actually. So creating a safety plan is one thing, but we should also connect with prayer, a prayer prayed in John chapter 17. Not long before he paid for our sins on the cross, Jesus prayed for us in a garden. And one of the things he asked his Father for, by the way, John 17, the high priestly prayer of Jesus, we both mention it a lot. It's been important in my life for a lot of years, John 17. And in this prayer that he's praying to the Father, one of the things he prays for is the protection of his followers. He says these words, "My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you protect them from the evil one." Right? From that roaring lion seeking whom he may devour, from that dragon, from the evil one. And that's huge, isn't it? Our role here on earth, with its pitfalls and its sinkholes and its trapdoors and its snares and its tripwires and its stumbling blocks, all kinds of dangers we can fall over or fall into or fall through, is to be here with all of that and to witness to the greatest, safest safety plan ever. Our Creator, our Preserver, the Governor of all things in our lives and in our world. And here's the thing. While the world can be harmful, God is faithful. Jesus knew that when he prayed for us, for his followers, to be protected from the evil one in John 17. And by the way, this is This is good, I think. It's not that Jesus did pray a safety plan over us, but that he does pray a safety plan over us. Hebrews 7:25 says, "Therefore, he, Jesus, is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them." I mean, that's a beautiful picture. Jesus praying in the garden not long before he was crucified for us, that's a beautiful picture. And Jesus in 2024 praying for all of us that live in this beautiful fallen world, danger lurks around every corner, praying for us now. That's a great thought, to know that Jesus prays for us constantly, interceding for us. So a plan, a prayer, and then to claim a promise. God the Father is still answering Jesus' prayer from John 17, and he's continually answering the continual prayers of Jesus on behalf of our safety. To list the biblical promises, all of them in Scripture, would take all day if we started doing that right now. It'd be a good day. That's a pretty good way to spend the day, come to think of it. But I'm just going to share three with us just in these closing moments. One is from 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 3. "But the Lord is faithful, and he will strengthen you and protect you from the evil one." So Jesus prayed, protect them from the evil one. And the Bible says, Paul says here, God will protect us from the evil one. It doesn't get any better than that. The name of the Lord, this is from Proverbs 18:10. "The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are saved." Incidentally, one of the ways that we follow Jesus here, one of the offerings of a safety plan that we give to the Croc Center Ministries community and to the community at large, is that we have, not once a month, not even once a quarter maybe, but periodically, we have what's called strong tower prayers. And we meet at the tower right in front of the pool, big tower with the cross, and we meet under it, and we pray about what's going on in the world, the dangers that are lurking in our world. And we've invited the community to pray with us. It's one of the parts of a safety plan that we offer here. And then lastly, this is Jesus' words again from John 16:33. I've shared before, it's quickly becoming my favorite verse. "In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." God knows it's dangerous out there. He knows. Jesus knew then it's dangerous out there. I mean, he was murdered. But take heart. We can take heart. We don't have to walk around this world of traps and snares worried all the time that we're going to fall and trip. He's overcome the world. Our mission, my mission, I'm finding, and I believe it's a mission for all Jesus followers, is to live in dangerous days with the love of a safe Savior. Like really knowing how much God loves us, and knowing how much, I mean, any of us that love people want to protect, how much more does God want to protect his little ones, his hens, bring them in under his care? I thought this week that there's really only one foolproof safety plan in the context that we're talking about, a safety plan. And that would be to constantly trust in Jesus every moment of every day, all the time, everywhere, all at once. I don't know about you, that's not my experience. I don't have a foolproof safety plan because I'm a fool. And don't point fingers, because I don't know all of you, but we're all fools. None of us can live a foolproof safety plan. And that's to be expected, actually. And it's already been thought of and atoned for. It seems to me we can make some disastrous mistakes when it comes to safety plans for our spiritual lives. I know I can and have. and do. Here's some mistakes. Not having a safety plan would be the worst, I think. We're talking about our spiritual lives. Not having any plan at all, kind of just going with complacency, like complacency is our word for the year. That's not a good route. I don't recommend it. Here's another one. Having one and not being familiar with it would be bad as well. Doesn't make sense to have a really sound safety plan that's just on the shelf somewhere. Creating a safety plan on our own, apart from God or the Word of God, sounds super dangerous when it comes to the spiritual life, when it comes to walking this world with all that it has to offer, the good and the bad and the ugly, the super dangerous. Creating a safety plan based on the Word of God and relying only on ourselves to keep us safe also doesn't sound good. It's a recipe for disaster, as the video said. The best route for us as Jesus followers, I think, would be to avoid complacency in our Christian discipleship by living by a plan that relies heavily on God's safety plan, as described in the Bible, and to constantly realize that Jesus prays over us and his Father will keep us safe. Jesus prays over us, bless you, and his Father will keep us safe. Maybe not by the world's definition of safe. That's important to say as well. Again, Jesus died on a cross. So by the world's definition of safe, did God keep him safe? But by God's definition, he was totally within his will and within his care. To quote another great English author, C.S. Lewis, in the Chronicles of Narnia, there's a time when they're talking about Aslan, and one of the kids says, is he safe? And the answer comes, no, he's not safe, but he's good. He's good. So we can trust in this safety plan that God has created for all of us through his son Jesus. We would love here at Croc Center Ministries to be a part of your safety plan. Your presence today indicates maybe that that's the case, that we're a part of your safety plan, and that's fantastic. Do not rely on us. Do not rely on this to be your entire safety plan in your spirit, for your spiritual life. There's a lot going on today, isn't there? It's fantastic. It's what happens when we all get together. It's great. As we continue to build on our connections, loving God and loving others, mistakes will be made. As I said, no foolproof plan. Mistakes will be made. Let's err on the side of commitment and not complacency when we're talking about our spiritual lives. And as the original sergeant of Hill Street Blues used to tell his troops every morning, let's be careful out there. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your creation. You've given us a beautiful world in which to live. And also, we've messed it up. And because of those mistakes, there are all kinds of dangers around corners. Help us to not make two mistakes with those. Help us not to totally dismiss them and think they're not there, but also help us not to dwell on them. Help us to dwell in you. Keep us brave and strong by your Holy Spirit. Keep us trusting in you and your sovereignty, and that you're good, even if not safe as defined by the world. And keep us following your son, Jesus, our Savior. Greatest safety plan ever. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bless you.
Thank you, Major. Thank you for the message this morning. Yeah, so we're going to trust God, amen? That's the plan, 2024. That's the plan. So we're going to invite you to sing these last chorus with us. And how about just letting go? How about just praise? Just raise your hands and trust.
Darkness, you have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're a help in time of need. Lord, I can't help but sing.
Welcome to come over here and let's just praise God. How about that? Do you feel like you can do this morning? Then just come and sing.
I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness.
This is you.
I will rest in your promises.
Go for it.
I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. Faithful you are.
Yes and amen. All your promises are yes.
Amen. Every once in a while, I like to kind of raise the curtain on like what goes on behind the curtain as far as church services are concerned. And one thing I want to share with you is that when Marina plans the worship, she only really knows the title of our sermons. She doesn't, very often, like this week, doesn't know the points, doesn't know all the scriptures that are going to be used. Very often that's the case. So to end our time today by singing, I will rest in your promises, my confidence. No, I will rest in your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness, right? I mean, that's the Holy Spirit. That's part of the safety plan. Love it. I love it when the plan comes together. One of the ways that we follow Jesus and part of our safety plan, and this is not a joke, is to eat together. So we would love to invite you to join us in the courtyard out to my left, your right, right past the offering tower, and join us for, I think it's cookies and coffee, but it might be something else, but there'll be something out there for refreshments for all of us to share in. And as again, on Tuesday nights as well at the open table, we eat together and have a good time together. Today's blessing comes from the pen of Isaac Watts, from the hymn, Our God, O God, Our Help in Ages Past. He writes these words, under the shadow of your throne, your saints have dwelt secure. Sufficient is your arm alone, and our defense is sure. Lord bless you.